A century ago, at Little Beach in Turkey, men from our newly federated nation went ashore at dawn. The place was Gallipoli, and what they did gripped the world and made history. Within a decade from these landings, our school was founded. None of its boys served in World War I, for they were too young. But scarcely a boy grew up without the legacy of a father, family member or friend who loyally served in the Great War. It is therefore fitting that 100 years later we should meet, show reverence and give thanks for their supreme sacrifice. What started at Gallipoli resonates through all of us to this day. We now share with you the lives of 12 of our earliest Knox boys. With the legacy of the First World War behind them, they suffered through the Great Depression, and when war resumed in 1939, to a man they rallied to our nation's flag. They now had their own Gallipolis to fight. These are their stories.
World War II is one of history's greatest, bloodiest, costliest conflicts. Over 60 million people perished. Of that number were just under 40,000 Australian soldiers who gave their lives in defence of their country. They fought for our freedom, our safety, and for what was right. Not all of these men were soldiers seasoned in combat. They were young and just starting life, many fresh out of school. Some were even still at school. Just think of today's Year 12 students, 17 and 18 year old boys with their whole lives ahead of them, putting down their school books and marching to such a violent, relentless war. It's a confronting image, too hard really to digest. The young Australians who gave up everything in the prime of their youth came from all around the country. Knox Grammar School was 15 years young when war broke out. The school was small, yet an incredible 609 boys joined the fight. Of a class of 1939, 78% of the year group served. 11 of 56 from the class of 1939 were killed in action, dying at an average age of 21. These were ordinary Australian boys thrust into extraordinary events. For school and country, focuses on 12 Knox old boys who served. Their time at Knox helped shape them into men, but no amount of schooling or training could truly prepare them for war. It is important to remember these men and what they did. Their actions kept Australia safe then and for all the years that have followed. We enjoy the freedoms and the luxuries we have today because of their sacrifices. They lost brothers and classmates, and the conflict changed them forever. We remember and thank them all. And most of all, we remember the 68 Knox boys who never came home.
Six hundred and nine Knox old boys served in the Second World War. The political origins of the conflict and the mentors that would prepare these boys for war both came from the First World War. We spoke to Richard Miles from the class of 1939. Like many, Richard's father had served at Gallipoli.
My father landed at Gallipoli at about 4:30 a.m. on the 25th of April 1915 as a member of the 12th Battalion, being part of the 3rd Brigade, of 1st Division, which was the covering force for the whole of the landing. The force moved inland over very steep terrain towards their objectives, which were not met because of the terrain being so difficult.
What happened that day was that the Australians performed the most extraordinary amphibious landing in the dark to invade Turkey. It was unprecedented, audacious, and they accomplished it magnificently, found reasonably light Turkish defences. They overcame the first line fairly easily, but then discovered that the terrain on the Gallipoli Peninsula made life very, very difficult for them. Some troops managed to get quite far inland, but they couldn't sustain the attack with a lack of supplies, despite their heroism and enthusiasm.
My father was wounded in the leg about 11 a.m. on that day, and after walking back to the beach using his rifle as a crutch from where he was evacuated to Cairo eventually.
It was a monumental action, monumentally dramatic and difficult, and the Australians weren't just there making up the numbers, they were an integral part of the forces attempting this incredible manoeuvre. No one knew at that stage that it would be unsuccessful. All of the talk was of this incredible bravery and audacity. So Gallipoli gained from the very first hours of its report this incredible place in the Australian psyche.
I was born in 1922, shortly after the war ended, and developed an early interest in World War I and asked my father quite a lot about it, which otherwise he may not have discussed. As a consequence of that, I became aware of the loss and sacrifice of war early in my life.
Captain Neil MacNeil served on the Western Front during the First World War with the Highland Light Infantry. He was wounded in the Battle of Loos in September 1915.
Well, the Battle of Loos was, I think, the most major attack of the British forces in World War I on the Western Front. Now, Loos was also interesting. It was the first battle where the British used gas, which didn't work exactly the way they wanted. So they launched the attacks, and it was disaster from the start, and the fighting was, dreadful. The British casualties, I think, were about 59,000 compared to 29,000 German.
For his gallant conduct during this battle, he was awarded the Military Cross. His citation reads, "He occupied and held with a few men against numerous counterattacks an important post, vital to the safety of our front line. He returned several times in order to rally men of other units."
For displaying exemplary bravery in the presence of the enemy. And just being at Loos and engaged in that terrible close quarter fighting, which they did, he certainly earned it.
Where many struggled to make the transition, MacNeil took his leadership on the battlefield into civilian life with great success. Neil MacNeil served as Knox Grammar School's founding headmaster from 1924 to 1939. The Rhodes Scholar saw the school excel despite the Great Depression, with enrolment figures growing from 28 pupils in the first year of 1924 to over 300 under his leadership, including a mix of day boys and boarders. Knox's curriculum expanded from academia, including the establishment of the School Cadet Corps in 1929.
Unfortunately, war is a place where survival is critical. Here at Knox, Neil MacNeil, the founding head, was a World War I vet. He knew that there was more conflict to come. And sadly, and I've read this, he knew that boys needed to be well prepared for that possible eventuality.
To prepare his students for what he saw as the inevitable conflict, MacNeil brought in Lieutenant A.J. Nixon, a Sandhurst graduate, to run the school's cadet corps.
Well, I was responsible for all the Loos guns. They had Loos guns and everything. And Mr. Opie was the bloke, and he said, "Look," he said, "here are the complete keys to the armoury, and if you lose them, you'll never hear the end of the trouble." So I didn't lose them.
Because, Barney, in the armoury, you had all those rifles.
We did.
Guns, and you used to take those rifles to the rifle range on the train and march through Chatswood with them.
We did, yes.
In its first 10 years, the Knox Cadet Corps would win 4 annual Kirby Shield competitions. Skills the boys learned while students at school would soon come into use when war broke out.
You had probably 90% of the fellas in them had never handled a rifle, didn't know how to slope arms, didn't know how to do that. Our job was you had to teach them. I mean, we'd learned it all at school, yes, okay, it was second nature to us, but we were few and far between. The general population had no idea, so we had to teach them all those sort of basics, doing long route marches, getting yourself physically fit. That was our training.
Trouble was brewing in Europe in the early 1930s, but it was a distant concern for Australians, many of whom still felt the loss of over 62,000 Australians in what was then called the Great War, supposedly the war to end all wars. Having veterans of World War I responsible for their education was undoubtedly a massive influence on the generation that would grow up to fight in World War II.
He was always in the background and spoke, and he was very, very keen at all times to get the most out of boys and just emphasise the desirability of discipline as a means of attaining this. And I can remember all the boys were sort of equivalent of cleared lower deck, I suppose, and formed a square, and poor unfortunate Clive Clifford was pulled into the centre of the square and expelled, as I recall, for having sworn. So it was pretty rigorous training.
He was a more distant Englishman style of man, a strict disciplinarian. Used to go around telling boys whether they had to go and have their hair cut, and or to have the pockets of their trousers sewn up because they were found loitering around with their hands in their pockets, which they thought was cool.
MacNeil, he was rather difficult to learn how to handle him. So the best way was to softly, and to do your best at whatever you were attempting. And you suddenly found that he knew more about you than you would ever know about him. And of a consequence, he would then start to take you into his confidence because he knew that you had confidence in him and in the school. And of a consequence, over the years, I became very close to Mr. MacNeil.
MacNeil had left the school by the time of Lyle's final year, but the impact the former headmaster had left on him was profound. They would often meet up in Melbourne and remain friends before MacNeil passed away suddenly in 1946. Discipline was paramount. Between firm classroom tutelage with the cane, cadets, boxing under the watchful eye of Alf Taylor, or competitive sport, boys were encouraged to pursue a range of athletic activities. MacNeil was not the only influential Great War veteran. He brought in many ex-servicemen to help run the school in its early days and shape the school's strong military culture. Knox Grammar School offered an encompassing, top-level education to its pupils. The time many had at the school would prepare them in ways they were yet to experience in the coming war.
Fellow Australians, it is my melancholy duty to inform you officially that in consequence of a persistence by Germany in her invasion of Poland, Great Britain has declared war upon her, and that as a result, Australia is also at war.
Yes, Ted served in the 2nd 1st Pioneer Battalion. and he was involved in the siege of Tobruk in 1941. It was a desperately fought siege.
They were enemy, as far as you were concerned. I didn't have a great deal to do with them in any manner of form or personal. They were out there in the field. They were there to be, they had to be shot and got rid of.
Conditions in Tobruk were pretty miserable. Anywhere within the fortress could be shelled by enemy artillery. It could be hit by enemy aircraft, so German Stuka dive bombers, for example. The whole town itself was under enemy fire and observation. It was hot, it was dusty. The soldiers didn't have a lot of, there was very little variation in diet. Not a lot to drink. All the water tasted the same. They used these metal tins. They all tasted like kerosene.
Ammunition, well, you got what you can. That wasn't too bad. Hygiene, at times, was extremely difficult. I mean, you just imagine yourself living in a sack trench and you want to go to the toilet. You can't get out. You can't put your head up. You can't do this and that. I'll leave the answers to that to you.
What was it like?
Sometimes a jam tin came in very handy.
John Reid brought his movie camera to war and captured some remarkable footage.
The bar on the battleship has just been torpedoed. She was listing to port, hit on the port quarter, and we were ordered to go alongside it. But as we were closing with NISAM to take off survivors, she was hit by a further torpedo and the magazine exploded, as you can see. And it was a horrifying sight. So, we had originally been, had it delayed, we would have been alongside and we would have also been part of that plume. As it was just before we got there, and it was a tragic attack, about 860 killed out of the total crew. You wouldn't believe that anybody could have got out of that at all, having seen it. In fact, I think there were about 400 or 380 that survived.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan.
World War II was the first time that Australia was in immediate danger of being invaded. If you think back to World War I, basically it was all happening in Europe. But for World War II, there was the Pacific War.
Japan's entry into the war in late 1941 gave Australia's future a dark outlook as it rolled over to 1942.
With Japan's entry into the war, Australia is now focused fighting a war and a conflict on our doorstep and also too on Australian territory.
They just wouldn't, they wouldn't give up. We were told that we were not under any circumstances to allow, as officers, anybody to send details of the cannibalization of the Japanese in respect to themselves and any of the fellows who were captured.
And we knew that we were being followed by a German plane. We tried to, you know, we did phase of action. Then I looked out the window at the front of the Lancaster, and engine on the starboard side had caught fire. So that was the beginning of the end. and the pilot said, abandon ship, I think. The escape hatch, or the main escape hatch, was underneath me. So I'd pulled it up. I got up and walked away from the plane, crashed almost behind me, and went off with an enormous bang and made a big hole.
Barney would be on the ground in occupied France for 8 long months, fighting with the resistance and on the run from the Germans until the Allies liberated the country.
This plane came in on the port side. I can remember quite clearly. He grabbed the firing position and opened fire and just kept firing again and again and again until the plane was chopped in half. And one half of it, for the pilot's section to the back to the tail, went in on the port side of the ship, and the other side, the other part with the engine and petrol and all that sort of thing, went over the other side of the ship into the water. And we the whole ship lifted out of the water quite immensely. You really sort of had your heart in your mouth and you prayed hard.
When you go on a mission, say about over the coast, you can see planes everywhere, just a few hundred yards apart. When it became dark, they're still there, but you don't see them. And they tend to, their navigation is not spot on all the time. One's diverging a little bit on the other, they're moving across, aren't they?
Yeah. It's only in the daylight when you realise how many planes were in the air at the one time. At night you never saw them and never worried about it, did you?
So how would you avoid colliding with these guys? And surely some planes did collide.
Well, they did, yes. And what's more, they were bombed by their fellow planes up above them. Used to come down to, but
did you see that yourself?
No. Well, not sure. We saw the planes going down.
Saw planes going down, but you didn't know the reasons behind it.
There'd be a scatter of incendiary bombs and all sorts of things coming down.
But that's what worried me when we started doing daylight raids, just to find out how many aircraft were in the air at one time. At night, you don't see them, and you don't ignore. You know, you think you're on the whole sky yourself.
We're also dropping napalm. Now napalm is a kind of oily petrol substance, and the oily substance is ignited by an ignition trigger, and you get this kind of liquid fire, and it runs down where the Japs were in trenches and dugouts. It's like a river. Is distinct from a bomb. Sometimes the bombs deflect it because the Japs have got logs over their dugouts and so on. But napalm can flow through the joints of logs and either burns them or the gaseous effect asphyxiates them.
This A troop lot were punching on board with them. Was attacked by about 100 Japanese, and they charged him, singing Bushido and Banzai, and almost got them, and they fought them back, and punchy then got onto us to send our mortars over, and so we did. And while they were reforming to have another go, we got our mortars onto the Japs and broke them up. It was in the wartime magazine. It was part I didn't know. It was actually one of the fiercest counterattacks the Japs did on any of the army blokes. So we broke them up and saw that. But I was throwing the bombs down in the barrel, and I got quite tired because, there's quite a few coming.
But we next day we wandered down the street, and they had these long white lines running down the sides of buildings to presumably would be an air raid shelter. But there was always great piles of bricks and everything, and you were left with the idea that there could have been maybe 30,000 people entombed during the war in air raid shelters in Munich. It must have been hell. They got a tremendous bombing in Munich. Anyway, we went into a doorway. We saw two fellas with Steiners, and Blue and I went into this doorway, and sure enough, it was a sort of a pub as such. But we're looking out a window there, and a couple of the German people, very friendly, came up and pointed to our wings, and they said, "And what do you do?" And Blue was just about to puff his chest out and say something, and I hit him on the arm and pointed out the window where you could see nothing but rubble as far as the eye could see. And I said, "We drive big trucks, big trucks." And that was that. But I don't think we'd have got lynched for saying that we were pilots. But my God, I wasn't really happy to say that when you could see the damage that had been done there.
We'd already lost one pilot. So we must have only left one at Biak, because we left one in the sea somewhere.
Whose major role towards the end of the war was in ferrying damaged aircraft back to Australia from New Guinea and the other parts of the Pacific. They'd be flying in a small group, and one plane would simply disappear and fly into the ground or into the sea.
Because I said to the CO down there, "How many have arrived?" He said, "One." I said, "One?" He said, "Yes." He said, "How many took off?" I said, "21. Well, he said, "You're the second in." We were all so furious about this that when I got back to Sydney, I asked one of my friends for an introduction to Sir Frank Packer. And I told the story to the Telegraph.
Yes, right at the end of the war in the Pacific, atomic bomb was dropped on Nagasaki on 9 August 45, and then the Japanese surrendered on 15th of August. Shortly afterwards, a three-man party from the Allied forces go into Nagasaki. One was an Air Force representative, one an Army representative, and a Navy representative, and that, of course, was Phil Stevenson. So he was one of the first of the Allied forces representatives on the ground in Nagasaki post-war.
Going ashore was a bit of an eye-opener. It was really such huge wreckage, and we went to Atsugi Airfield to pick up an aircraft to go down to Nagasaki, and the airfield was a mass of wrecked aircraft. And everything was a shambles. And we were met by the Kempeitai, the Japanese secret police, which are pretty horrendous people. I got the job of clearing the port of the wreckage. It was a hell of a mess to clean up. So it was an interesting time. The Japanese workforce were surly and but not hostile. And we eventually got enough cleared so that the ships could come in to take prisoners of war off. And then we got the prisoners of war off, and I saw a couple of Knox boys that I did know.
The bombs dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki secured victory against Japan. The world was no longer at war. Our student soldiers could finally come home.
These are a group of men who were born in the aftermath of one war, a war which cost the lives of 62,000 Australians. They came to their adult lives through the Great Depression, a level of economic adversity unknown to my generation and certainly that of my children. They then came to their adult lives under the shadows of a war that was coming. From a nation of 7 million people in 1939, a million Australians mobilised, including these men who were then young men, of course, having come from Knox. They mobilised a million. Half a million of them went overseas. 30,000 of them were imprisoned 22,000 prisoners of the Japanese. 8,000 of them died as prisoners of war, and at war's end, 40,000 were dead. This was a generation of Australians who regarded their responsibilities to one another, our nation and its future, as being far more important than their rights. In fact, they regarded their responsibilities as shaping and defining their rights. And then, having seen us through the Second World War, they set about the economic and social reconstruction of our country.
Those that survived had to make the best of getting on with their lives after the war. For some, this was easier said than done.
Physically, I have been okay, but emotionally, I've been flawed. The family have been extremely tolerant.
How did you find then leaving the Air Force and then settling back into Civvy
Street? Very difficult. Very, very difficult for a 22-year-old.
I was a bit lost.
That was very difficult. Not easy at all. It took a lot of willpower. We used to find that we couldn't sit at the desk all day or all the morning. Every now and again you'd have to get up and go for a walk and then come back to it.
And how the lads from the various divisions who went through absolute hell, how they existed, I really don't know.
But it's something that I would not wish on anybody, and if it can be avoided, avoid it. But on the other hand, if your country needs defending, well then it is up to us to go and help in any way we possibly can to defend the country and the life and the existence that we have.
Brendan, what would you say to the boys at Knox today when they look at that honour board and they see those names?
Every one of those names was a young man just like you, an Australian who had a life, who was loved and loved others, who enjoyed the privilege of going to Knox Grammar, benefited educationally and personally from that experience, and then when the time came and his country called, he answered that call voluntarily, and then in the service of our country, wearing the uniform of our nation under our flag, he gave his life for us.
As the war years become further in the past and our great veterans age, the importance of passing on their stories has grown. In 2002, Mr. James Wiley and the Knox History Department organised the Living History Day. 15 Knox veterans came and spoke to the boys of the day about their war experiences.
The Living History Day was an attempt to teach our Year 10 history students better than we'd ever taught them before.
My left here, Mr. Richard Miles. There are Thew. Don Corbett Smith. And David Nesbitt.
It was also very clear to us how much they loved Knox and how much they loved an opportunity to serve their community and to serve the current boys of the school.
One can only imagine the thoughts and feelings of these veterans when looking at the Knox boys of today around the school, for they were just as young when war broke out. On another occasion, Barney Greatrex spoke to Knox Prep School boys at their Remembrance Day service in 2011. The 11th of the 11th of the 11th.
And you know, boys, we tell you the story so that you can then tell other people the story, because these stories should be remembered. They're wonderful, not just Australian stories, they're Knox stories. And it's important that you have this history of Knox and understand the wonderful men which Knox has produced, so that then you keep telling the stories to your sons when you send them here. So haven't we been lucky today? Were you expecting that sort of story?
No. Unbelievable.
Unbelievable story, and it's a living story.
If the youth of Australia today should take only one lesson from these veteran stories of courage and survival, what do you think it should be?
Gratitude for the role that they played and the sacrifices they made to give them the freedom that they're enjoying today.
Courage and determination in the face of often impossible odds.
I think the one lesson must be that nations must do all they can to avoid war.
The most fragile yet powerful of human emotions is hope, paradoxically. But what most sustains and strengthens hope is the belief that you can shape your future and you can be supported in shaping that future, and the way in which you do that best is serving one another. And ultimately, it's a legacy. We commemorate war, we commemorate sacrifice. We don't celebrate it, but what we do celebrate is a legacy we've been given from the First World War through subsequent generations, that in the end, a life of value is one in which you are reaching out in support of someone else, even at risk of your own life. That's the lesson that they have, I think, given us.
What do you think it should be?
I think it should be that we have a responsibility in our time to protect those things which we value. When we look back at what happened, you know, whether it's World War I or World War II or any of the other conflicts that have been part of our nation's history, people have to stand up and take responsibility. And that's the message, I think, to young people today. As sad as it may be, conflict is part of the human condition. We need to know that we may have to do this, and that's a great example from the past.
They shall grow not old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them, lest we forget.
Phil Stevenson stayed with the Navy after the war, serving in the Malayan Emergency and the Korean War. He was the skipper on board the Melbourne when the Evans collided with it back in 1969. He was cleared of any wrongdoing but chose to leave the Navy and join the gas business. He would later cross paths in business with Ted Carter. He spends his time today between his home in Burradoo and Sydney. Lyle Roberts would join his family's jewellery business, Fairfax and Roberts, and would serve for many years as the president of the Australian Spitfire Association. John Hore-Lacy never forgot fighting the Japanese. After the war, he travelled the Australian countryside. He eventually went back to farming in Moss Vale, where he had grown up as a boy. He still lives there today. David Nesbitt came home and worked with the British cotton mills, and then for 25 years worked for the American Olympic Tire and Rubber Company as their technical services manager in New South Wales. Ted Carter, after surviving Tobruk, El Alamein and the jungles of New Guinea, had had enough of war. His preference for a quiet life saw him move to Tamworth, where he established a successful accounting practice and had six children. He has a nice life. Arthur Pardey came back to his family's flour milling business, but his love of the opera that he'd acquired in Italy during the war saw him buy a house where he lives today with his sons, looking across the harbour to the Sydney Opera House. John Reid returned to the family engineering business that he had left to go to war. His movie camera captured incredible historic footage that he donated to the Australian War Memorial. He still enjoys his time in his garden today and plays tennis. Don Caldwell Smith, Smithy to his crew, worked for Shell Petroleum and ran the famous Redex car races around Australia. He stayed close with his best friend and buddy, Don Rowe, who had been his radio operator on board his Lancaster. The pair lived a suburb apart from each other and were inseparable. Don Rowe sadly passed away in May 2013. Eric Thew never quite got over his psychological scars from the jungle, but returned to the books and fought on through the courts as a barrister. He set up home in Wurunga. He's still there today. Richard Miles, Dickie Miles to his schoolmates, is a survivor of the class of 1939 and lost too many friends to the war. He has been a leading force in remembering and honouring our Knox veterans. He too calls Wurunga home. Barney Greatrex escaped the Nazis, Gestapo and the Vichy French to survive in occupied France for 8 months before General Patton rescued him and Bomber Harris flew him home. Returning to Australia, he established a very successful business in gaskets and clean air equipment, which he still runs today with his nephew. My friend Barney lives alone in St Ives. He feeds his horse and prunes his roses. At 94, it's been an amazing life. John Hordern finished his arts degree at Sydney University, majoring in archaeology. The war had created a fondness for travel in him, and afterwards he sought business agencies from German tool manufacturers abroad to represent in Australia. He exchanged stories with his German suppliers who had fought with Rommel and survived Stalingrad. He would tell them when his cruiser had taken on a Japanese battleship and won. My dad died in June 2013. He was 88 and was the first of our 12 Knox veterans to sadly cross over the bar. There is not a day that goes by that I do not think of what these veterans have done for us and how 68 of our fellow schoolmates never came home to a world without war.
In some ways, I find myself the last man standing and still speaking publicly about those whom we commemorate so regularly at the school, from a knowledge of whom they were as real living human beings, rather than a list of names of people we honour and commemorate each year. The ranks of those who knew them are thinning as time moves on. May I commend their sacrifice and service to younger old boys, and through the headmaster to students moving through the school and into the ranks of the old boys. They are worthy of your honouring and remembrance of them now and in the future.